Good evening, I'm Stephanie Sauvé. I'm the Vice President of Academic Life and the Dean of the Faculty at Colgate-Rochester Crozier Divinity School. And on behalf of our President, Dr. Marvin A. McMickle, I bring you greetings from the Hill and gratitude from the Hill for the opportunity to be in this stunning sanctuary and to be embraced by the beautiful people who are the St. Monica Church. We are so grateful for the opportunity to bring a little bit of our lecture week from the Hill into the community and to be here at St. Monica's this evening. As you know, this lecture continues tomorrow, and we hope you'll come up to the Hill and join us for worship at 9:30 and then the lecture to follow. So I want to now introduce the pastor of this church, who actually is everyone's pastor. If you know Ray, he becomes your pastor. And so I invite Ray Fleming, Father Ray Fleming, to the podium.
Yes, you.
Good evening. My name is Ray Fleming, and I'm the pastor of Emmanuel Church of the Deaf. I've been doing that for 32 years so far. Well, it wasn't supposed to be funny. We have several people from our Church of the Deaf who are excited about coming tonight. And for 11 years, I've been pastor of St. Monica's Church as well, so far. And the folks from St. Monica's Church are also excited to be here tonight with you all. Because the school on the Hill is really a wonderful place for our community, and maybe the best kept secret of the wonderful education available in Rochester. I must confess also that one of the students from St. Bernard's I'm a former student of St. Bernard's, so I'm a little bit afraid of the school on the Hill. But now you have come down from the Hill and are here with us. And we are so grateful and honored that you would come to our two churches here for this lecture and worship this evening. And I am thrilled to see Sister Barbara here, who's one of our wonderful, wonderful people, who's been inspiring to all of to us for so many years. And Sister Simone Campbell is here. And that is another, just a powerful honor that she would come here to see our two churches here and to see all of you in our community. I just want to welcome you all. And as part of the welcome, I'd like to do a little sign language lesson this evening. Two things. First, deaf people, we don't hear, right? So clapping doesn't do a whole lot of benefit for us. So how do we applaud? It's like this. It's pretty easy, right? Also, one more sign I'm going to teach you, one word. Amen. Now, it can depend on a couple of things how you'd sign that. In a formal setting, do this for amen. Amen. Now, if we are thrilled and supportive, that's amen. That's a good old amen. Again, so welcome. Thank you so much.
Please stand if you're able for the call to worship. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, to let the oppressed go free, to comfort all who mourn, in that challenge and reality, we gather this evening to worship God and remember our call to live into justice and compassion. Amen. Please join me now in the prayer of confession. Good and gracious God, we come to this holy place this evening, well aware of our limits and the many ways we have failed to respond in love to one another. We are also aware of your grace and gifts and the power of your Spirit in our lives. Keep us open and responsive to the challenges and wisdom of the coming days, so we may be voices of truth, compassion, and wisdom. Our opening hymn is Total Praise.
Oh, A reading from Acts chapter 15, beginning in verse 6. The apostles and the elders met together to consider this matter. After there had been much debate, Peter stood up among them and said, "My brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you that I should be the one through whom the Gentiles would hear the message of the good news and become believers. And God, who knows the human heart, testified to them by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. And in cleansing their hearts by faith, he has made no distinction between them and us. Now, therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing on the neck of the disciples a yoke that neither our ancestors nor we have been able to bear? On the contrary, we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus, just as they will." The whole assembly kept silence and listened to Barnabas and Paul as they told of all the signs and wonders that God had done through them among the Gentiles. After they finished speaking, James replied, "My brothers, listen to me. Simeon has related how God first looked favorably on the Gentiles to take from them among them a people for his name. Therefore, I have reached the decision that we should not trouble those Gentiles who are turning to God." The word of the Lord.
Just a word before I begin my reflections on the politics of diversity. Many, many thanks to this community of St. Monica's. The hospitality, the staff, the music, our signers, and your dear pastor. This place launched me into pastoral ministry, and in so many ways, I am deeply grateful. If the Greek word polis means city, it is logical that we could also refer to the work of the people in that city or community as politics. And if diversity is a reality about the variety and experience among us as a people, then it is also logical that in both civic and religious matters, politics and diversity often find themselves at odds or at times in harmony with one another. But both of these realities, politics and diversity, touch deep issues within us and often are seen as threats to one another. In this election season, we observe this tension, don't we? We experience it play out in speeches, debates, suggested policies, language, in what may be more insidious, clear, but at times coded words. politics and diversity are often at odds with one another. And you and I see this reality playing out in our scripture text this evening. This tension is as old as the human family, and it can express itself in our own family units, churches, and government. This evening's reading from Luke's Acts of the Apostles presents you and me with a religious, cultural, and political community problem. A problem that was emerging from the growing diversity within the new Christian family. Questions arose among Jews believed to be God's chosen ones. How, in that context, could they relate to those who were different? To grow into their new faith was one thing, but that new faith was now expressing itself among different people and in rather dramatic ways. The story of Peter and Cornelius's family demonstrates that reality. Because of their chosenness, the question is, were the Jews, the first Christian believers, were they deserving of or entitled to a special place in this new community? Now, this question makes me ask, who in our modern society believes they are chosen or entitled to some special status? Were those called later and outside the umbrella of chosenness now perceived as second-class citizens who had to accept the norms and some practices of the chosen to be accepted in this new Christian family? And this question also makes me ask, if there are some among us who see themselves these days as second-class citizens. My dear brothers and sisters, we should never, ever underestimate the importance of this first century discussion and the decisions that followed. Nor should we underestimate the impact and importance of similar discussions these days. For example, what is the relationship of our Muslim brothers and sisters to other faith communities in our nation? How do we accept and treat Latinos and other immigrants, including refugees from the Middle East? How do we deal with chosenness as it rears its head in systemic racism? These questions that deal with the acceptance of diversity and the development of public policy are all around us. In the first century, why was the acceptance of the Gentiles into the Christian community such a threat? And why is diversity a threat today? Because acceptance necessitates a change in attitude. It necessitates a broader understanding of God. It necessitates a rethinking of the concept of chosenness. It necessitates a letting go of fear, and it necessitates a willingness to see the goodness and gifts in the other. the first century church, the 21st century world. Many of these experiences are the same. And so we return to the text to ask ourselves, what prompted the early church to change its mind and its policies? And I see five things in the text. I know preachers generally use three. I see five things in this text that help to bring about that movement and change. And this evening, I am suggesting, in fact, I am urging that these five things be brought to bear as the election nears and as we currently discuss politics and diversity. First, Justo Gonzalez, in his book, The Acts of the Spirit, reminds us of the prominence and importance of the Holy Spirit in the first century and in Luke's writings. We see that power at Pentecost and in other events like Peter's encounter with the Cornelius family and the work and ministry of Paul. In fact, in the 12th verse that Katrina read, the text tells us that Paul and Barnabas reported to the church in Jerusalem all that God had done among the Gentiles. That presence of God's Spirit is alive and well among us today and waits for our call and our openness. It can save us from ourselves and broaden our vision. Secondly, Paul listened to the men and women who came to know Jesus and his message. We know from Paul's letters that Peter had a little trouble with the issue early on and vacillated. But the two appear to have listened to each other and to the Gentiles, and together they moved forward. I think in our culture we lack that gift of attentive listening to one another. Thirdly, the early church community took seriously the experience of others. They came to realize that other folks experienced Jesus in ways they did not, but it was real and it was authentic. When Peter recounted his experience with Cornelius and Paul and Barnabas reported all that had been done among the new believers, they understood their experience. And fourthly, as the early church made its decision in Jerusalem, they drew on their holy books. James quotes the Old Testament and says, "Thus says the Lord, who has long been making these things known." I fear we Christians have domesticated Jesus. When we read the New Testament and we either ignore his radical commitment to the vulnerable or we don't take it seriously. And finally, compassion and compromise were at the heart of this first century decision. Both Jews and Gentiles were asked to make some concessions here. And we hear the church leader saying, "I have reached a decision that we should not trouble the Gentiles who are turning to God." Compassion and compromise. But above all, compassion is the most central piece, and it should be for you and me. And so, my dear brothers and sisters, as we continue this lecture week, reflecting on the intersection of religion and politics. May the first century church be a model for us. May the teachings of Jesus Christ call forth our better angels to act in love and compassion, respect and truth as we face the next few weeks together. Amen.
In your words, order my tongue. Let us join together in prayer. O God, our souls rejoice that in the mystery of the ages we are named your people, and you, our God, O God of justice and mercy. We come together from many places, from many kinds of faith. We are a ragtag people gathered here, and yet in the hospitality of your spirit, tonight we feel that we are one, and our souls rejoice. They also quake, Lord, at your voice, calling us to lives of justice and mercy as well. The petty voices of our time wither before your challenge to serve righteousness before we serve self, to become as the poor and the meek, standing with them and for them, washing their feet, giving them voice through our voices in the halls of power. And so we confess before you what you know, that we are more often than not weak, prevaricating, uncommitted to the way of Jesus, your chosen one. And yet in your hidden wisdom, you beckon us with him and in him to leave the easy road and be your people and prepare your way. Look at us, God. We are such raggedy people. And yet in this call, we laugh with Sarah's laughter. we rejoice with the blessed yes of your daughter Mary. And so we come before you with the world in our arms like a lamb entrusted to our care. We stand before you on behalf of all those led to slaughter in our day. And in the silence of our hearts, we name them before you. With those names, those peoples, those children in our arms, we long to offer ourselves to your commonwealth on earth without holding back. Holy One, renew in us the vision of your promised land far off, and give us courage to set our hearts on bringing it to realization on earth. When we falter, in your mercy, renew us and call us forward. And give us the power of such love for you, for this human family, and for all your creation, that we may always go out in joy and be led forth in peace. For we are confident we go in the company of your Christ, our brother on the way, in whose holy name we pray. Amen.
We will be singing our closing hymn and a benediction, and we will be ending just a bit early. So in case some folks are coming for the lecture closer to 7, we invite you to take a close look around the church and ask any of the parishioners spots that they should see. There's a beautiful statue of Saint, we Catholics love statues. There's a beautiful statue of Saint Monica over here as a black woman, beautiful. And Our Lady of Fatima, which our Portuguese parishioners love over here. But, and then very close to 7, we will begin the lecture. So let us stand for the closing hymn, He's Blessing Me.
Making a way somehow, over and over.
the opening line of the hymn he's blessing me over and over again is what we at the Divinity School are saying to you folks at St. Monica's. Thank you. Such a blessing to be here. Thank you to the choir, and I know what Jennifer did, recording all the music because she couldn't be here. We will, after the blessing, take a few minutes because some folks are coming for Sister Simone's lecture, so please get to know each other a bit. And so may Almighty God, our good and gracious Creator, bless us, those we love, those we're concerned about. And may we make every effort we can to be a blessing to others. We ask all of this in the name of our Creator, our brother Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, the source of passion and love in our lives. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Just a couple of announcements. If you go on the Colgate Facebook, this whole service, and in fact our lectures, are being streamed. I'm not good at that, but they are. That's what my friend Tom is doing. Just a reminder that tomorrow at 9:30, our dear friend Diane Bobes, is she here? I saw her. She's preaching tomorrow. She is our recruiter from the Divinity School. And we will have a second presentation from Sister Simone at 10:30, and then there is a luncheon. I would like to introduce Sharon Herring, who is one of our students, and we have a practice at the Divinity School that our students become the ambassadors for our guests. So she got Simone, she shepherded Simone from the airport to her hotel and here. And then Mia Richardson, where are you, Mia? There she is. She's the ambassador for tomorrow. So Sharon is going to introduce our speaker.
Good evening, everybody. I don't usually stand at one of these things without singing, but I'll spare you all that. I've only been able to spend a few moments with Sister Simone, but we are in for a treat. She's a wonderful lady, I can tell. She's a wonderful spirit. So, without further ado, Sister.
Thank you. One of our sisters works in the deaf community, and my congregation, my religious community, has gotten into this. But my problem is, many people don't know that this is clapping. And I do it in all kinds of places, and they look at me like, is she gonna dance? What's happening? So I am very grateful to have your presence and for me to feel free to clap. Thank you. Tonight, I am honored to be here in this nest. During our prayer, I felt like, isn't this a nest of nourishment? A place where we can come together and breathe a sigh and not look at Facebook posts or Twitter or our news feed or our Instagram or whatever. And we can spend some time tonight reflecting on what in God's green earth is going on in our nation. And hopefully in this process, to touch a piece of the anguish of our time, but also to encounter a bit of hope. Now, one of the challenges about doing two talks is that one talk has a little more anguish, and the second one has a little more hope. So I don't want anybody leaving too depressed tonight, but do come back tomorrow. I picked the question from Ezekiel, can these bones live again? Because so much of what I feel in this political climate as I travel around the country is that so many people are dry, are parched, are disjointed, feel fallen on the ground with hardly anything to connect them. And for me, this question becomes really key when I realized that the early Greek democracy in Athens was a vibrant democracy for about 200 years. And then the rich families started fighting with each other. And once the rich families started fighting with each other, one of the families sold out Athens to Sparta, the warriors. And when you look at what's happening right now in our nation, we've had a vibrant democracy for about 200 years. We have now greater and greater income disparity. We've got rich families fighting each other. And I'm worried, who is Sparta? We also have the military-industrial complex as the way of strength, not the strength of our people. So remember Ezekiel. Ezekiel asked the question, well, God picked him up, took him to a valley, and made him walk up and down and look at the bones to see just how bad things were. He says, he led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley. And the divine asked me, can these bones live? And I said, oh, sovereign, you alone know. Then he said to prophesy. I want to spend some time on just what the state of these bones are, and then where politics calls us in this time of challenge. Yesterday, I was in Indianapolis at a service site where adults are learning, trying to get their GEDs, getting prepared for work. And we had this amazing conversation about what their struggles are. And one woman, Thomasina, just captured my heart. She is struggling to get out of an abusive relationship. She has two children. She herself was so frightened about voting because she told me she was terrified she would do something that would hurt our nation. Seeing all the ads, she just felt it was gonna be bad. and she didn't want to do something bad. She told me that last week she had sold her car for $150. She said it was a clunker. But she sold her car so she would be able to buy her two kids new school clothes, so they would not be made fun of as school started. She was so proud that she could be a good mother to them, but she was so worried about the violence they had already seen in their lives. Her oldest is 9, her younger child is 7, or almost 7. And these two young folks for her are what keep her going. But she worried about our nation and that whatever we choose would be bad. I met Angela in Bloomington, Illinois. Angela's a mom, also getting out of an abusive relationship, but she is a Korean immigrant. She married a serviceman and came with him back from Korea to the United States. After they got back here, he became quite controlling, quite abusive. He was having trouble in the military and he was having trouble in the marriage. She finally got away, but her 4-year-old son had witnessed a fair amount of violence. He was speaking at 2, 3, but at 3.5, he quit talking. And she's terrified about what's happening to him. She has a very complicated immigration situation. She doesn't have her permanent residence. She's caught in limbo. It is a mess, and the lawyers are trying to straighten that out. But her big focus and worry is what's happening with her son. He's seen so much violence already at 4 years old. What's happening to him and to her people? Only to discover that in Bloomington, Illinois, it's called Bloomington Normal. I love that a city would be called Normal, but it's not normal at all, because in this metropolitan area, there are no child therapists. There are no child therapists in Bloomington. Her only option to get some care for her son is to take her son to Chicago, 1.5 hours away. And she's a low-income mom who can't do it. So she's terrified, but trapped. Thomasina and Angela both are examples of dry bones in our society, where they feel so disconnected and hurt. I met Layla at Vincent Village in Fort Wayne, Indiana. She and her family experienced homelessness, and finally, they have permanent housing. And she was so excited to have permanent housing. And she herself struggles with bipolar disorder, but as long as her medication is balanced, she does really well. But bipolar tears her apart periodically, and she had recently, or the way she lost her apartment before, was by going through an episode that was really extreme. And Layla asked the question, how do you move forward when the cookie cutter has no room for me or my family? That's the challenge that we're facing, is that these disconnected bones are expected to be in a predictable order and a predictable setting, and they're not. The anguish of this time is that we are all separate, laying on the valley floor, trying to pull it back together. On the bus this summer, we went to Cleveland to the Republican convention, which was a wonderful experience, a little terrifying. But when I realized our bones are really, really dry and worrisome was when one of the sisters on the bus said to me, because we were worried about violence in Cleveland, and I asked the sisters to tell me if they were worried about something so we could respond to their concern. And Margaret said to me, well, Simona, I really would like to know what to do if there's an active shooter. I'm not so good at running anymore. And I realized the level of worry and concern in our communities when we're not so good at running anymore. We had a National Security Administration briefing from somebody in the administration. So just in case you want to know, what do you do if you don't run? If you can't run, you're supposed to run, it's the first thing. The second thing is hide, but not in a place where you'll be caught. Which is like, how do you know that when you're in that situation? I'm not quite sure how that works. And then the third thing is, if you can't hide, then you're supposed to attack with loud noise and throw something. Oh, okay. Those sound like really good options. But what I realized was that the anguish of the division and the apprehension that we worry about that, and in the African American community in this time, a week before last, I was in Chicago and we were talking about the level of fearful violence and police problems, and the fear is huge. And we become more and more isolated. Individual dry bones. In St. Louis, I met this group, Mothers to Mothers, and one mom told us that she quizzes her, she's an African-American mom, and she quizzes her sons regularly on what to do when they're stopped by the police, not if, it's when. And what she says is that she drills them so that they keep their hands out of their pockets, their arms away from their body. They say, yes, sir, no, sir, and they don't get any teenage attitude. Now, she has an eighth grader and a 10th grader. And I don't know about you, but by the time I was a 10th grader, I had a lot of teenage attitude. So I don't know how a 10th grader pulls that in. But that's her way of keeping her sons safe. And the week before I met her, her eighth grader said to her, Mommy, how long is this gonna go on? And she said she had to look at him and say, the rest of your life, the rest of your life. She and her sons are dry bones in our valley of our nation that are desperate for something new. And then there's Kathy Dahlkemper up in Erie. You all are pretty close to Erie, though I always forget it's a different state from y'all, but Kathy is the county executive, and she is trying to get better transit for the people in Erie County. And so she pulled together $250,000 to provide to the transit district so the buses will come out into the county, out of the city. Sounds like a great plan, doesn't it? But the mayor turned down the money, because he doesn't want to lose power over the transit district. And if he accepts money, then maybe his power will be eroded. And so the people suffer. The people walk home from their late night jobs because there's no bus service. Our people are on the floor of the valley, and what are we going to do? And finally, if I'm making you miserable enough, I want to add to this Jason. Jason is an entrepreneur. You would think he would not be a dry bone in the valley, but he is. He's a, he's got probably a couple $1 million and when I met him, and probably has more by now, but he was getting upset that he realized that his taxes, his tax dollars, which he was happy to pay, unlike some other people I could name, that he was getting upset that his tax dollars were going to fund his competitors. And I said to him, "What? Your tax dollars are funding your competitors?" And he says, "Yes." He, Jason, pays all of his workers a living wage. His competitors don't. And so the low-wage workers have to use the social safety net to survive. They use food stamps, Medicaid, housing vouchers. And what Jason had realized is that his tax dollars were funding the safety net. Now, he said he was happy to provide a robust safety net for people who fell on hard times. But what was making him angry was that his competitors could outbid him because they had lower personnel costs, because they paid low wages. See how that works? So Jason was saying everyone should pay a living wage, and the safety net should not be a business subsidy. See how that works? Then I talked to other business people about Jason's worry. And Jason, and this one guy said to me, "Oh, Sister Simone, that's really nice that you're worried about it. Very nice. But we have pressure from the financial sector to have a high profit. And if we don't have a high profit, we lose our investors. And so if you want me to reduce my profit by paying better wages, you have to make me do it. We need a law." We've tried to get a law in Congress, and they say it's a job killer. It's not a job killer. But because we're so separate, so torn apart, such dry bones in the valley of our nation at this moment, we don't see how we need to be woven back together again. Can these bones live again? As I was thinking about this, I have tried to figure out, how did we get in this mess? Do you ever wonder about that? I have a lot of theories, but the one that I can really point to, unfortunately, I'm a Californian, and I hate to say this, but it was our two presidents that we've exported from California. Neither one has been real stellar, so I'm sorry, I apologize, but we sort of shipped them out. But Ronald Reagan changed how we think of our founding story as a nation. I think Ronald Reagan started the drift towards making us all these dry bones in this valley. When he had this great ad about the one man riding on a horse into the West to settle the West. The West was settled by one strong man. Well, I watched television as a kid, and I know that it was wagon trains that went west. It wasn't a single individual riding off into the west that settled the west. It was community. But what he did was change the narrative so it was that we were settled by the pioneer man being strong. Well, if you only had one guy or one wagon and you were in trouble and you yelled, "Circle the wagons," and you only have one of them, it's not gonna work. Or if you've got a barn raising and only one person shows up to raise a barn, it's not gonna work. Or, and this I know from personal experience, if you're trying to make a quilt for the winter and you try to do it by yourself like I tried to do, it was the most ridiculous thing I ever did. 5 years in, I decided I would invite my friends over for a quilting debee to finish the blessed thing. It only took us one additional year, but it got done. But you can't do these things by yourself. Our nation is founded not on strong individuals riding off into the sunset. Our nation is founded on we the people. We are community, and we need to reclaim it. The dry bones that lay on the floor of our political valley in this moment, I think, are the result of excessive individualism. An excessive individualism that says, my bone is alone and I'm special, and I'm not connected to anyone. It's wrong. But in our certitude, in our determination to be individualistic, we're laying there on the valley floor rather than pursuing rising up together. And our wealth as a nation perpetuates this myth that we can go it alone. I did a business roundtable in Chicago, it's about a year and a half ago now, because I wanted to learn what does business need for the common good and what do they contribute to the common good. And it had just come out that the average salary for a CEO of a publicly traded company was $10 million a year. And they were going for $11 million. So I got to say to these entrepreneurs sitting around the table, well, guys, and they were all guys, don't, no offense to the guys, is it that you're not getting by on $10 million that you just need a little extra mil? And this one guy said to me, oh no, Sister Simone, it's not about the money. It's not about the money? Well, you could have fooled me. He said, no. The thing is, we're very competitive and we want to win. It just happens that the measure of winning is money. Wow. The measure of winning is how big is my salary? The measure of winning is how much of an endowment do we have? The measure of winning is dollar signs in our current society. And that competitiveness is leaving us dry on the valley floor when we win at the expense of another bone laying right next to me who I don't even see. The challenge of this political season is that individualism and isolationism is tearing the fabric of our society apart. Look at the presidential debate. The presidential debate where not paying taxes makes a candidate smart. Not being involved makes him smart. Not being engaged in service makes him a good businessman. It's anguish. And then we see the reaction of our people when we touch that bravado, that brazen approach, it touches an anger in many. And the anger is directed at the diversity, at the very thing that you were talking about, Sister Barbara, that we are different. And that's the glory of God, that we're different. But when people are frightened, they react. And as I've thought about this, praying about these dry bones, because in many ways those that are angry are most dry. And what I realized was that I believe, this is my theory, so I have no idea if there's data for it, but I believe that the reason they're angry is because they actually were fooled by party politics that were against their interests. They've suffered over the past years because of it, but rather than being able to own the fact that they were duped, they lash out at people who look different, and that they claim it's their fault. And the hardest part for many of us, as we know, is to turn that pointing finger at ourselves and say, I'm part of the problem. I was fooled. Oh, glory. So we are in this mess of isolation, blame, anger, walking up and down among those rattling bones, and it's driving me nuts. Can these bones live again? What are the protective sinews that can pull us back together? How can we find a way forward in this vast wasteland of our nation at this moment? How do we not just turn off the television, disconnect from the world, and stay in our comfortable nest? It's nice here, isn't it? It's great singing, it's beautiful, it uplifts my spirit, so let's stay. It's like the being at the top of the mountain in the Transfiguration. Let's stay. But where we're called to is to walk up and down that valley. And as I walk up and down the valley, I want to give you some glimpses of sinews that are beginning to connect bones. In Little Rock, Arkansas, or it might have been Nashville, and I'm a little forgetful, but I think it was Little Rock. We did we were on the bus last fall, and we did a town hall. And this one, we had tables, round tables, and this one group sat together, introduced themselves. And this group of seven people discovered they all lived in the same neighborhood, but they didn't know each other. And they were shocked. How could we live within three blocks of each other but not know each other? So they did a little problem solving. How did that happen? And what they realized, what they said to the group was, this is how they became dry bones. They had a garage attached to a house. They had an automatic garage door opener. They had air conditioning in the house. And they had a private backyard with a swimming pool. And because of that, they never saw their neighbors. because they had everything they needed to be special. So you know what they did? They decided that they were going to start sitting on their front porches, waving at people as they went by. They had no idea if it was going to make a difference, but they wanted to at least know people's faces. In another town we were in, we met a group of people who lived on the other side of the tracks. Actually, it was the other side of the freeway. And they had we were there in September, so in March, they had driven around to the wealthy areas to see what the wealthy areas had that their neighborhood did not have. And they came back with a long list of what they needed. They needed street lights, street signs, they needed curbs, they needed sidewalks, they had this long list. And then the question was, where do we start? What do we do first? You know what they decided to do first? They decided to plant flowers and vegetables in the front yard of the various houses on the street. It was actually a couple of blocks. I think it was like three blocks. And then in the summertime, when the vegetables were growing and the flowers were blooming, they invited the mayor down. And the mayor saw a neighborhood that was taking care of itself. And they asked then for the streetlights, the sidewalks, the curbs, the street signs. And we saw the mayor, and the mayor said they were very effective. We're getting them the sidewalks first, and in the next budget, we're going to try to put in the other things because this neighborhood cares. It's weaving together where we do things together. It's a basic attitude that we are in this together. So, what do we do in the midst of this? Well, I have a quote from Pope Francis. It's so much fun to quote the Pope and be happy about it. You know, there was a bit of unpleasantness, but you know, the unpleasantness led to the bus, which led to the notoriety. So we say at our organization, the Spirit works through all of this. So we say, should we send the Vatican a thank you note, do you think? I don't know. But Pope Francis says that what is needed is a politics which is far-sighted and capable of a new integral and interdisciplinary approach to handling the different aspects of the crises of our world. He goes on to say, a strategy for real change calls for rethinking processes in their entirety. For it is not enough to include a few superficial ideas, while failing to question the logic which underlies present-day culture. We have got to examine this culture of individualism, the culture of money as the measure of winning, the culture that says I can say anything I want against anyone else. I can have an anger that I can exhibit without restraint. When we walk through the valley of the dry bones, we need to know we have to look deeper, breathe more deeply, and prophesy to those bones. Prophesy to the bones to come together be connected, live in this time in a way that we have not done for quite a while. We need each other. It is not possible to have these bones live and not be connected to everyone. That is the challenge that we face. And so as we do this, we have a serious responsibility, those of us that share faith. Because the faith that leads us to the place of seeing Thomasina and her struggle for her kids, seeing Angela and her worry for her four-year-old, seeing the struggles that exist here in Rochester, and seeing the fact that Layla doesn't have to fit in a cookie cutter. Seeing that those in the Republican Party who were really grim and had such a hard time creating hope or thinking of what could bring them hope, we have a responsibility to all of these. Now, one of my favorite things is in Paul's epistle where he says, we are one body. We are one body, and we all have to do our part. And so what I think tonight is about is to acknowledge that we're sinews, that we're connected, that we're engaged, that the only way that these bones can live again is if we reach out, if we touch where the pain is, if we embrace those who are weeping, if we weep with those who weep, if we let our hearts be broken open. Because the thing I've discovered is when my heart is broken open, there's room for everyone. No one can be left out of my care. Even some politicians that I'd like to vote off the island, we continue to have to care for. Because the fact is, the only way the bones will live is if we acknowledge that we are connected. And when we have eyes to see the sinews and the connection, then we can stand up and the breath of the Spirit will again revive us. That is our challenge. That is our prayer. That is my hope. And so what I have come to know is in the Christian tradition, the story of Ezekiel for our time is about having once again the Spirit of God embody flesh and bring us together in a love that surpasses understanding. It's that love that creates the change. And so to close, and then we'll open it up for conversation, I want to read one of my poems. It's called Incarnation, because I really believe that the way these bones can live is if we again see the incarnation. I wrote it in Iraq, actually. In 2002, I went on a delegation to Iraq, and it was in December before we invaded, and that night, the last night we were in Baghdad, it's so funny. The last night we were in Baghdad, we had gone to an Italian restaurant, partially because we knew it had a generator so they would have hot food. But when we came back, there was a wedding party in the light from the plate glass window of our hotel. And there, we watched the folk dancing going on. There was this accordion and a screechy old violin. And we got drawn into dancing. And this guy stood about this tall, leans over and says to me, as he's trying to show me the folk dance, he says to me, how long do my niece and her new husband have to live in peace? How long until you start bombing us? That night, it was so visceral for me that we are one body. This is the poem that was given. It's called Incarnation, and it's my prayer for us that these bones might come together. And it goes like this. Let gratitude be the beat of our hearts, pounding Baghdad rhythms, circulating memories, meaning of this journey. Let resolve flow in our veins, fueled by Basra's destitution, risking reflective action in a 15-second world. Let compassion be our hands, reaching to be with each other, all others, to touch, hold, heal this fractured world. Let wisdom be our feet, bringing us to the crying need, to friends or foe, to share this body's blood. And let love be our eyes, that we might see the beauty, see the dream, lurking in the shadows of despair and dread. And let community be our body warmth, radiating Arab energy to welcome in the foreign stranger, even the ones who wage this war. And let us remember, on drear distant days, we are a promised Christmas joy. We live as one, this tragic, gifted life, for we are the body of God. Thank you so much. Now for my favorite part, which is the conversation. I hear myself talk all the time, so now I would like to, questions, comments, what do you think? I've never done this before. You have to turn both on. It's a miracle.
Such a smart student, see? I'll come to you.
So raise your hands if you want to make comments, ask questions. What do you think? I'm curious. Okay, in the back.
Did I see a hand?
Yep.
Oh, Beth.
I heard Glenn Beck and with Chuck Todd following Michael Moore, and I liked what Glenn Beck said, and I want to say what he said and see what you think. So he said, first of all, he had warned about the alt-right, so he was concerned about that. But he said about the state of society is that we're at a moment where we need a Martin Luther King or a Gandhi, and there's no Martin Luther King or Gandhi at the national level, so therefore it devolves back to the local level for us to come together. And he said the prevailing words are win-win, but what it should be is reconciliation. And I know you talked about your neighbors there, but are there other, and I'm also, I'm not saying this as an answer, but if you could talk about the Higher Moral Ground movement.
Oh, sure.
I see your picture was there with Reverend Barber and Forbes, if that's part of what might be happening. So what about these local movements that should be happening? If you agree with that, it seems to make sense to me. I never,
absolutely.
Glenn Beck makes sense to me.
And here's my challenge. I still have tomorrow, so I can't go too far down that road. But what I would say is that there is a lack of innovative thought at the national level. And there is a lack of innovative leadership. And when, I mean, I'm just a Catholic sister, and I can get press and stuff like that, you know, we're desperate. So for a leader that will stand up, the local areas, it's not the most flattering way to describe it, but I think local areas are petri dishes of new possibilities. You're trying new things out. We desperately need innovation and new ideas and new ways of coming together and breaking it open. Let me give you an example. We were in Asheville, North Carolina, and they had passed a living wage ordinance. The state legislature, which is, you know some of the trouble in North Carolina, the state legislature took away their authority to pass that kind of law. But you know what Asheville did? Asheville didn't, I mean, they went and complained and protested and all this stuff. But they also then said, all right, what else can we do? So the nonprofits went together to certify businesses in Asheville that were paying a living wage. And then they went to the newspaper and got the newspaper, I believe it's every month, to publish the list of businesses that are paying a living wage and run an ad saying, support these good businesses. By the time we were there, it's a year and a half ago now, there were over 400 businesses certified as paying a living wage. But see, it was the creativity of when one door closed, it's not being stopped by it. But the urgent need of these bones to come together are urgent enough that we'll find another way. And only that can be done at the local level. We need you to do that. So don't get stopped, get determined. Tomorrow.
Excuse me. What is the mindset of people who purport to follow Jesus, and yet they feel that the individual approach is the right approach for them in the future of this country?
Oh, yes. I wanted to include brain transplants in the Affordable Care Act because they annoy me, but it is true. Paul Ryan is a great example of that. He takes his faith seriously, he says, but he defines subsidiarity as individualism. And he believes that it's his responsibility to care for himself and his family without help. He does not get that we are a community to share a communal concern. I think his community stops at his front door. I have encouraged him to come, what I call, come meet my people. Come meet my people, so that he knows how he is connected. Well, but he told me he'd been to an African American church. And then I checked up on him, and yes, he went to an African American church on a Sunday morning. He sat in the front row and he didn't talk to anybody. Oh, please, Paul. He's very awkward. He's very shy in some ways, and he needs the bravado of position and the distance that notoriety gives him. He's not good at talking one-on-one with somebody who's not powerful. And so my compassion for him is trying to acknowledge his awkwardness and trying to lure him into more relationship. Because the fact is, usually it's fear or a sense of insecurity that causes this desire for individualism. And so it's very hard. The other piece is this idea of the prosperity gospel that's very strong, especially in the southern part of our nation. When we were on the bus in the South, it was shocking to see these signs about if you're loved by God, you'll be blessed with riches, which then says that if you're not rich, you're not loved. And that's where we have to be stronger than that and become missionaries for the love that these people are so hungry for. I mean, it's anguish. And the other piece is, let's just be real about it. There are a whole bunch of people that have made a lot of money and are very happy, and money is the measure of winning, and so they've won, and they like winning. So part of it is trying to erode that reality.
My exercise.
Oh, you are. You're gonna get all your steps in today. Sort of jealous.
Sister Simone, thank you.
You're welcome.
My question is, in terms of the levels of you've described, can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay. In terms of the levels you described, you talked about the three women, and you talked about the person that's the entrepreneur, and you talked about these gentlemen at the table. And generally, the concept of moral injury has been used as a broad military term. But if you look at what you described, the issue of moral injury is affecting all those people you're talking about.
Ooh.
And not only that, if we think about it deep enough, that moral injury in terms of those gentlemen at the table, their competitiveness is really affecting and causing a lot of problems that they might not understand in terms of individualism, where not only moral injury becomes an injury, but it becomes a pathology. And I think we need to look at that more and in terms of community awareness and discussion, and talk about how we identify those issues, not trying to hijack from the military moral injury, but how to use it as a mechanism for healing, and just to open up, you know, because we keep on opening up, pulling scabs off our wounds.
Yeah.
We need to let that heal.
Yeah.
So.
Good point, and thank you for bringing that up. Two things in my mind. One is, okay, I'm doing this moral revival with Reverend William Barber and Dr. James Forbes and Reverend Tracy Blackman and me. And Reverend Barber wanted me to be a part of it because, well, he and Dr. Forbes hatched this idea and got Tracy to, as one woman, to join, and then they got me to join them. And so I'm the white woman. I'm a Catholic sister, not quite used to the revival style. So my little talk when I'm with them is a lot quieter and a little more contained. But what Reverend Barber's talking about is that moral indignation, the moral outrage. Now, bless me, sisters and brothers, for I have sinned, because I do have trouble with moral outrage. Because I have trouble being that judgmental. And I know, I mean, it's okay for Jesus to do it, but I'm not sure it's okay for me. So here's the way I've kind of made peace with that. Because, let me tell you the problem. The problem is that the contemplative life, to be alive in the Spirit, requires radical acceptance. A radical acceptance of everybody, even the ones that annoy me. So even though I want to vote them off the island, I have to accept them, like my conversation about Paul Ryan. That's what I'm trying to do. But then there's also, once you've gotten to radical acceptance, you have to fight also. And it's fighting, what I've realized is it's fighting for a vision. So the way I try to raise the moral thing is not with a wagging finger like, you're morally corrupt, as much as I would love to do it in my not good days. But what I try to do is to say things like, in the richest nation on earth, it is wrong that our people can work full time and still have to live in a homeless shelter because they can't afford rent. Okay, but it's wrong because of the context. And so we fight for a vision where everyone, where all these bones can come together. See the difference? Yeah. But we needed moral voice. I was also at the Ford Foundation. I have all these experiences. Kind of join, you know, lead a quiet life, join the convent. That's my recommendation. So I was at the Ford Foundation, and we were talking about faith and public policy. And one of the higher-ups in the foundation asked this very interesting question. He acknowledged that we need moral language in this time, which goes back to the lack of national leaders. We need moral language in this time, but how does a progressive movement that doesn't have faith create a moral language? And I thought that was a really interesting insight, which then puts more responsibility on those of us of faith to be called to that place of, dare I say it, prophecy? I won't claim that word for myself, but maybe that's what the times demand, is more of a confrontational, I don't know. You can tell I'm an extrovert. I think out loud and then talk myself out of something, but. Okay, Sister Barbara's on the hunt.
Hiding behind the pillar. So to go back to your Homeland Security briefing, where they said in an active shooter you run and then you hide and then you throw things and scream, I feel like Donald Trump is the active shooter in our society, and the people that are coming along behind him are also becoming active shooters. What do we throw? Like, obviously chairs and desks and rocks are not a good choice, but like, as people of faith, what do you say we throw?
Well, I'll tell you what we've done at Network, because I'm seriously concerned about the rise of hate speech and the parallels between 1930s in Germany and this are horrifying. And so I got really worried that institutional folks were taking a pass because it was political. And so we at Network started 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago? I forget, 2-3 weeks ago. We started a bigotry watch for all the presidential candidates where we're calling them out. And when they stray, now if they're just doing personal attacks, we had to draw a line. If a personal attack, like on Miss Universe, that's the stupidest thing I've ever seen. But anyway, that we said didn't rise to our level of bigotry. But what does are things like in the presidential debate, we called him out for how he used his white privilege and denigrated Secretary Clinton's attempt to articulate a more nuanced view of privilege and the effort at implicit bias, acknowledging implicit bias. So we called him out on that. The very first day we started this, we called him out on, his son tweeted, and of course, this whole campaign is being done on Twitter, which, you know, 140 characters gets you a very in-depth analysis of our issues. But we called him out when he said that Syrian refugees were like a bowl of Skittles. Yeah. I mean, that's horrifying, horrifying. And so what we're doing is we're using social media. We do press releases. We try to get more in the press, but try to be bold and say, stop it. This isn't politics. This is humanity. It's not about being politically correct. It's about being human. Being human requires us to embrace everyone and not create hate and divisions. Stop it. So that's what we're trying. But I really think faith folks are called in this time to stand up to it. But it's not happening a lot. And often what we do as faith people is we couch it in ever-loving, thoughtful ways about not wanting to hurt anybody, and we're not going to really, so we never really say what we mean, which goes back to the moral piece. I guess I may be better at it than I think I am. But But it's that clarity. Stop it. And I'm hoping we'll draw his fire. I don't know. We'll see. I can dream. Thank you. Good
Evan,
to see you.
Since Nazareth last year.
That was great. I think your microphone has a little trouble.
I think it does, too. It's tilted.
Just tilt it this way, like that.
Like this?
Ah,
thank you.
Magic.
Okay, to get back to Paul Ryan.
Ah.
He's from Wisconsin.
Yeah.
Right? Now, I have experience with Wisconsin because we've got relatives there. And they think differently than we do. I mean, if you know the Green Bay Packers, that's how they think, in my opinion. They're not bad okay. people. They're very generous. But they like cheese. You know?
And that hardens your arteries, and that's a problem.
I've listened in family gatherings to how bad the Democrats are, and et cetera, et cetera. And it's like no one, in at least in that setting, defended the Democrats, and I kept quiet because I didn't, you know, I was all by myself, so to speak. But the people in the Middle West think differently. They're, as I said, they're not bad people. And the farther west you go, I mean, you can get to Arizona and you get Sheriff Joe Arpaio, who doesn't think at all like most people.
Okay.
So I just think we have to, it's a hard thing to take in the whole country.
Amen.
And I just prayed it turns out all right. Thank you.
I think we're all joining in that prayer. But let me just talk a little bit about thinking differently. This is the challenge, is if we are all one body, and Jesus didn't just say, those of you that get along are one body. I mean, he had fights among the apostles who wanted to be first and second and where people were sitting. And I mean, there were struggles. So why should it be any different for us? The challenge is we think of ourselves individually, and in the individual, then I ought to be with people who like me, who agree with me, who get along with me. But what you have to know about Wisconsin is that Janesville, where Paul Ryan is from, part of the town is represented by Paul Ryan. Part of it is represented by Mark Pocan. Paul Ryan, as we know, is a Speaker of the House. He's a Republican, conservative. Mark Pocan is a Democrat and a member of the Progressive Caucus. So two guys with very different perspectives got elected by the territory around this one town. So it's not that we have to wipe Wisconsin off the map, so it would neaten up the border. Or as what I do, my sin is that I think global warming, lose Florida, wouldn't be so bad, would it? The challenge is, is if we are one body, then our faith challenges us to include everybody in our care, regardless of how nutty they are. So at the Republican convention, I think I got sidetracked on telling you my Republican convention story. At the Republican convention, we asked three questions. We interviewed people. We did the same thing at Democrats. We asked three questions. Who in your family is it difficult to talk to about politics, and why? Now, at the Republican convention, they said, oh, those Democrats, oh, they're just impossible. And at the Democratic convention, they said, oh, those Republicans, you know, every family has one, it's a real problem. But then we said, the second question was, what worries you in this election cycle? And many of the delegates told us that what worried them was that there wasn't a good choice for president. Many of the Bernie supporters in Philadelphia told us what worried them was there wasn't a good choice for president. The biggest difference was the third question. When asking Republicans what gives you hope for our nation, a lot of them had hopes, but a fair number of them would go, well, huh. And this one guy said to me, the Constitution? As if there was a right answer, and did he get it right? Now, the difference was at the Democratic convention, while the other first two were quite similar, everybody had some hope. Everybody could point to something. Everybody could say, oh, this is happening, or that's happening, or, you know, this idea, or that idea, or, you know, making progress, or, you know, the Affordable Care Act gives me hope that we're going to get to single payer, or, you know, those kinds of things. But what I realized was that when a party is fueled by anger, it suppresses hope. And if we don't have hope, we don't have a vision. And if we don't have a vision, then we're dry bones in the valley. That's the big difference. How long can we go? Oh my gosh.
Do you want to take two more questions?
Sure.
Good evening, Sister Simone.
Good evening.
Now, I listened to Dr. Barbara's message, and I wrote two words that came from the message she delivered since evening. Compassion and compromise. Those two words.
Interesting.
I see these two words carefully knitted into the quilt that you have just presented to us. And my question is, have we lost this feeling of compassion? Are we no longer care? So we are still somewhere in the valley of dry bones. You have become so dry that we no longer care for the persons or those around us. Is compromise, does that make you a weak person? Or when I said weak, because this is the way of probably where you're viewed. If you are doing the things that are right, you're seen to be somewhere along the line a weak person. Is that so?
Mm-hmm. Good questions. And on the compassion side, I would say, when do we weep? When do we let ourselves weep? And if our hearts have not been broken open, if we haven't wept, then I think maybe compassion died. But it's also about our obsession in our nation to fix everything. So when we get the least bit hurt, like with Thomasina, my temptation was to try to fix it for her as opposed to just hold her and weep. And so I think Walter Brueggemann really talks about this. If we want to nourish a prophetic imagination, if we want a community to nourish prophetic imagination, he says you have to touch the pain of the world is real. Don't fix it. The fixing comes with that other place where it comes organically together. When I've wept with you, I'm forever shaped by you. So I'm always connected. Let me tell you a story. Can I give you an example of this? Because on the first bus trip in 2012, we were in Cincinnati, and Jeannie and her partner Lynn brought me from Jeannie's sister's memorial service the picture of Jeannie's sister, Margaret. Margaret died at 56 because in the recession she lost her job, she lost her health care, and even though she knew that her family had a propensity to colon cancer, she couldn't get screened. Margaret died because the Affordable Care Act was not fully implemented. And well, it actually wasn't implemented because it was 2012 and it was just getting ready to be implemented. But in the states where Medicaid has not been expanded, Margarets are still dying. And so Margaret has fueled my passion for Medicaid expansion and healthcare reform. This is like a holy card to me that I carry with me. That was 2012. In 2014, we're in Lexington, Kentucky, and at a rally on the bus, and a woman comes up, puts her hand on my shoulder, and says, "I'm Nancy, I'm one of Margaret Kistler's sisters, and I just want to say thank you to you for helping to heal my family." And she walked away. And I go, "What? Did I hear that?" So I got up and I ran after her and got her. And she said that the five other siblings were fighting with each other over Margaret's death. "You're a nurse. You should." They were guilty. "You're a nurse. You should have looked in on her. Well, you had money. You should have bought her insurance." Or, you know, all those kinds of things that families do when they feel guilty. But my talking about Margaret made some sense out of an otherwise senseless death. And this is where I know one body. I'm fueled by Margaret's life and her sister's passion that they brought me her picture. But by doing my part, it's healing to them. The miracle is that I knew, that I got to learn of that ripple effect. So for us, in compassion, when we have compassion, it's love that goes out. But rarely do we see those results. And the issue is, actually, the issue for me about demanding results, I was on retreat, and I do this contemplative prayer, and so I was asking God for something special, because I'm special. And just before retreat ended, something special. So I go to our retreat director, and he said, "Oh, so you'd like a sparkler of the Spirit. Is that what you want? A little sparkler that could brighten up your time." And I realized, yeah, I did. But isn't that individualism? Because it's in community that we see the sparklers of God in our relationships with each other. And so the challenge is to be community. Okay, two more questions. I can go on forever.
Good evening.
Hi.
First of all, I want to thank you for your reading from Ezekiel. Out of all the times that I've heard Ezekiel and talked about the dry bones, I've never heard it presented so well.
Oh,
and I want to just thank you. And I say that only because it really, really, really touches me to hear me and feel me, dry bones. So I just want to thank you for that. Secondly, I want to say that I have the pleasure of attending Colgate Rochester Divinity School, and in attendance, I have had the luxury this semester to be a part of the class that is being taught about, and I hope I say his name right, Dietrich Bonhoeffer.
Oh, yes.
And for me to hear what you just said in your conversation and to read what I'm reading as far as he's concerned, and to hear you say something that really, really, really hit home with me, as far as, you didn't say it exactly like this, but when I see a situation of our presidential election where it is now, and I read and compare back in 1930s and 40s with the Germans and Hitler, I don't think we're too far from that.
Amen.
And it not only just scares me, but it moves me to a point where, okay, if we sit and stand in this room and discuss, is that going to change things? Because don't everybody faint, but I'm 59, and I find that time moves a lot faster now than it has ever moved, okay?
I'm more than 59, and I sure know that.
Okay,
yeah.
So with that said, November will be here before we know it, okay? And if I compare Germany and Hitler, and very short from less than 60 days away from election, and what could potentially happen to this beautiful country that we all live in, and we do nothing. What is it that we can do other than talk in this room today,
amen,
or any given day,
amen,
and make November look different than what we possibly could see November becoming?
Amen.
Thank you.
Okay. This is tomorrow's talk. So thank you for the plug for that. And it's way too much to do tonight because I really want to lay it out. What do we do? Because I think for people of faith, it is probably one of the most urgent questions that we cannot afford to wait on, because it's not 60 days, it's almost 30 days.
Yeah, I just,
so today's the 5th, election's November 8th. Hey, we got work to do.
Here's a question. That gentleman had his hand up. I want to be respectful. Oh, okay. Do you mind?
I'll be
right over.
Okay,
but
she's going
to
come.
Just before, I'm thinking of this so I don't lose it. You all got a wonderful green sheet. And if you would just fill out the evaluation and leave it in the pew. If they don't have one, they're at the door.
Housekeeping.
All right, Holly.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm a student also at Rochester Colgate, and we're reading your book. You touched on this a little bit a few minutes ago when you talked about Walter Brueggemann, but in your chapter on touching the pain of the world, you said something that really resonated with me, and I was wondering if you could elaborate on it a little bit. You said the experiences that you had in your various encounters are nourishing for you because being with real people and dealing with real issues is sacred. And then you went on to talk about the Old Testament scholars and Walter Brueggemann and living the gospel. Could you just elaborate on that a little bit about the
about
sacredness?
Yes. Oh my gosh. Let me tell you about an exchange with Tiffany yesterday. We were doing this group at the GED and the work training site, and there were about 25, 30 people in the room. And then Tiffany, who's 19, it turns out, came up to me afterwards and didn't feel comfortable saying it in the large group. And confided in me that she had dropped out of high school when she was a junior to care for her dying mother. Her mom died. She was still 17. She gets sent to live with her dad. He becomes physically and sexually abusive to her. She gets caught in, she got taken into the juvenile dependency proceeding, even though she was 17, and ended up going to be with a kid from her class, formerly, that they were friends. So his mom said she could come live with them. That was right around Thanksgiving. That November, in November. Then the 4 days, I think it was, before Christmas, they get an eviction notice because the landlord was selling the house in a gentrifying part of Indianapolis. And they all had to move and they had no place to go. And she, I mean, all I could do was weep with her. But it was so sacred to hold her, to try to comfort her just a little bit. I have no idea if I succeeded, but she changed me for my worry for her. And what happens for me in those sacred encounters and vulnerability and sharing stories is that I often feel like a cup, a vessel, receiving sacred blood of folks that are poured out. And that sacredness is humbling, but also nourishing to my commitment to doing my part so that Tiffany might be able to do hers, that she might be healed. One hug, one sharing of tears won't be the healing, but maybe it'll create a little open door so that she can journey, I hope. But can you see how it's sacred? It's sacred. And so in ministry, we have this ultimate humbling honor to receive so many. And I really think that was, I did this talk for the UU, the Unitarians, and their big thing, and it was all about walking towards trouble. You know, so often we think in our individualism, oh, don't cry, don't get embarrassed, don't, you know, keep tough. But that's just individualism talking. In spirituality, we walk towards, and that's what Jesus did. He was forever walking towards trouble. It's a sacred moment. We have one last question. Yeah, the interpreter needs a mic.
We're going to switch places here.
Oh, okay, good.
First, you are so lucky to have an interpreter like him. Because when I was born, I was, you know, born deaf, grew up deaf, and American Sign Language is my first language. English is my second language. The word compassion, always people say, like, love and mercy, kind of included. But this interpreter signed something new for me. This sign, which is more like cherish and care for. So love and mercy could be like have pity on someone, but not really have relationship with. So I think God asked Adam and Eve to be responsible for caring for the earth and to cherish it. So I think that's what the meaning of compassion here. So when will our politicians learn that lesson? When will man learn that? When will men and women figure this out? That love and mercy is not enough in that sense. We really are responsible to cherish and care for. And that really challenged me. You know, which politician should I vote for? It's a real challenge for me. And one doesn't have any compassion or caring. And the woman is a mother, so she understands, she cherishes her children. But thank you so much for your presentation. I truly enjoyed it.
Whoa. The compassion as that caring is key. And the idea that it is not distant, it's not me being over there, it's this, that we get woven together into the fabric of our society, then we can hold all of our tears. It's the gift. So tune in tomorrow for the next episode, Can the Bones Live Again? Thank you.
We want to thank you so much for being with us tonight. If you have one of those green sheets for evaluation, please fill it out and leave it in your pew. If you don't have one, Debbie has more, and she'd be happy to give one to you. so that you could tell us anything that would be helpful as we continue to do this Lecture Week series. This is just the beginning of the Helen Barrett Montgomery Conference that's a part of this week. And we'll be at Colgate Rochester Crozier Divinity School tomorrow at 9:30 for worship with Diane Vose, and then another amazing lecture that you've already been invited to, like I counted 12 times. So thank you. Tomorrow at the Divinity School, when this woman who is just a nun, oh, and just an attorney, and just the executive director of Network, a lobbying constituency in Washington, D.C., and just one of the nuns on the bus, will speak to us again about how to be compassionate and how to be caring and how to be filled with mercy and how to flip things over in this political system and walk towards the fear and not run away from it or throw things at it. And so we invite you to continue this conversation and to continue the spirit of this place tomorrow morning on the Hill at Colgate Rochester Crozier. Have a good evening. Thank you.